Bam!
Mr. Drew, in this video, we are going to be taking a look at finding out how to write the equation of a line that passes through two given points. Indeed, this line right here. We're going to find the equation of the line that passes through the point 1, negative 2, and 10, 4. We have it already graphed. We have the point here of 1, negative 2. And move over, we also have that second point labeled as 10, 4. Now, in your algebra class, you're going to be given problems asking you lots of questions about finding equations of lines. Some of them will give you a point and a slope. Some of them, like this, will only give you 2 points. You may be given a point that the line passes through and then told that you're writing the equation of that line that has to be parallel or perpendicular to another line. We're only focusing on this type of question today. And regardless of what is given in your problem, if you're asked to write the equation of a line, we need to realize that the minimum requirements are just, you know, bring to front that you need a point and a slope. That's truly what defines the placement of a line in a two-dimensional place or space. You need to have a point, okay? So we're going to pass through this point of 1, comma, negative 2. Our coordinate of a given coordinate of x and y. And then as we move along this two-dimensional space, we're going to have some particular direction to follow. So we have a set point in space that the line has to go through, that point 1, negative 2, and we need to rise a certain amount and run a certain amount to get to that second point. Well, that is the direction of the line. The minimum requirements to write the equation of a line is a point and a slope. So if you're asked to write the equation of a line and you're not given a slope, that's step number one. You need to figure out what that is. Now, to find the slope of a line, I'm going to use a yellow for this. Well, first you have to have some idea of what the idea of the word slope means. And in your class, you may be using the word gradient. Well, the slope of a line is simply, like I said, the directions. How do you get from this point in space to this point in this two-dimensional space? Almost like you're, you know, looking at your phone and asking for the GPS, telling you, how do I get from home to some grocery store or to school? Well, you have to go a certain direction, like maybe north and then west around your blocks to get from home to school. What are those directions? How much do we have to rise over how much we have to run to get from one given point to another? So the slope of a line, you may say, is rise over run. Now, depending on the book that you have, there is a few ways of describing or labeling what this means. If you move up, you are going from, well, if you move up and down, you're changing values along the y-axis. So that rise is you going from a y value, in this case, a y value of negative 2 to a y value of 4. Now, maybe you can do that quickly in your head, but I'm going to focus on the development of this idea as opposed to just giving you formulas to follow. One way of describing how far up you go, another a label, is to say a delta y. Now, your book may or may not be using this notation, but the idea of delta for change is a math symbol that's going to come up a lot more the higher up through mathematics you work. So this idea of slope being the amount you go up or down over the amount of run you go over, that it can be described as a change in y. So how much up or down do you have to move, and then how much to the right do you have to go, or delta y x, to go from point 1 to the other point, in this case we're about to label, I can do that now, as point 2. So slope, you may have heard, hopefully in your class, is rise over run. A really super mathy way of writing that is delta y, that's read a change in y, over delta x, a change in x. This is another way of saying rise over run. Okay. Now, your slope can be either a positive slope, and I like to read graphs left to right like you read a book. That's going to be a rise value over a run value, a change in x, as a movement to the right. You may have a negative slope, which is going to be a movement down, over a movement to the right. I like to teach slope, my rise over run. Not that it's an absolute mathematical requirement, but I always like to read left to right. So the positive and negativeness of a slope, a graph that is rising versus a graph that is falling as x increases, is determined by, are your y values getting larger as you move to the right, or are your y values getting smaller as you move to the right? So if I'm gonna call this 10 comma 4, the second point, well then I'm gonna call 1 comma negative 2 the first point, or x sub 1 comma y sub 1. Okay, so far my notation for slope is a little bit mathy looking. If you move up along the y-axis, how far have you moved? We went from negative 2 on the y-axis up to y value of 4. How far did you move? Well, you can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or you can do 4 minus negative 2 and get an answer of 6. So slope being rise over run can be written as delta y over delta x, but if you are early on in your algebra journey, you're probably going to see that as y sub 2 minus y sub 1 over x sub 2 minus x sub 1. Okay, so let's get this started. So the slope of the line passing through these two points is going to be calculated by doing y sub 2, so the second number in this parentheses, 4, minus, always use parentheses when you do substitution, 4 minus negative 2, over x sub 2, which is 10, minus x sub 1, which is 1, and so we have a slope that is 4 minus 2, which is basically going to be 4 plus 2, over 10 minus 1, which is 9, so we have a slope which is equal to 6 over 9. Yep. So our slope in reduced form is going to be, well, I'm going to write this, 6 over 9, which is going to be equal to 6 divided by 3 is 2, 9 divided by 3 is equal to 3. So now I've calculated a slope for the line passing through the points of 1, negative 2. And we can see that if we go up 2 and over 3, I get a point that line passes through. If I go up 2 and over 3, I once again find another point that's actually on that line, falls on the line. And if I go up 2 and over 3, I once again hit that point of 10, 4. So the reason I'm highlighting this is because any two points you use, as long as those two points are on the line, you're going to get that same slope, the slope of a line which is constant. And that's going to be important for the second part of this problem. So step number two, now that we have a slope, we're just going to pick either one of these points. It doesn't make any difference. So I'm going to, for the second part of this question, pick the point of 1, negative 2. That's going to be the x and y that I use to write the equation of this line, along with the slope, which is, we've just found, to be equal to 2/3. Okay, now where am I going to put these numbers? Where am I going to put this value of x and this value of y and this slope? Okay, without just giving you a formula and saying use this because I said so, let's take a look at that slope formula again. Slope is the change in y sub 2 minus y sub 1 over the change in x sub 2 minus x sub 1. If I take this equation for slope and I say I want to get rid of that fraction bar. I want to get rid of that division of x sub 2 minus x sub 1. If I multiply both sides of the equation by x sub 2 minus x sub 1, the multiplication of x sub 2 minus x sub 1 and the division of x sub 2 minus x sub 1, well, those are going to cancel out. And that's going to give me x sub 2 minus x sub 1 times the slope is equal to y sub 2 minus y sub 1. What I'm really doing here is deriving the point slope form of a line, which is my favorite form of a line to use when I'm writing the equation of a line. You can use any two points along a line, and if you calculate the slope, you're going to get the same answer. So in other words, when you go to write the equation of a line, all you need is any point along the line. Pick whatever you feel is going to be the easiest. If you want to use 1, negative 2 because the numbers are small, then use 1, negative 2, which is what I'm going to use. If you want to use 10, 4 because the numbers maybe, even though are a little bit big, you don't have to deal with a negative, then let the point that you're about to use be 10, 4. I'm going to use smaller numbers and deal with the negative. And no matter what point I pick, as long as I use that one point and the slope of 2/3, I'm going to get the right answer. Now let's come back to the slope formula that we all know is rise over run. I don't need two points to write the equation of a line. I need one point and a slope. So I don't need to have an x sub 2 notation and a y sub 2 notation because I don't need to work with two points. This right here, only you'll probably see it in your book, is y minus y sub 1 is equal to m times x minus x sub 1. This is the point slope form of a line. It's nothing more than a manipulated version of the slope formula. We're going to put our given x and our given value of y in for y sub 1 and x sub 1. So maybe I should put some subscripts in here, which means we have y minus the given y value from our coordinate, which is going to be negative 2, is equal to m. We had to find that on our own. Our slope is 2/3 times x minus x sub 1. That is the point slope form of this line. If I start at the point 1, negative 2, and move with a slope of 2/3, I'm going to, over and over again, hit some points that are on this line that we've now defined. If your negative 1 times negative 2 is y plus 2 is equal to 2/3 x minus 1, if your problem does not give a specific direction of what form to leave your answer, you're done. However, if your test or your teacher requires you to show this answer in slope-intercept form, well, slope-intercept form is y is equal to mx plus b. So slope-intercept form means you have to have the y variable by itself. And what's really handy about that is the number that's in front of the x is your slope of the line, and the b value is the y-intercept. So this is really nice for graphing. We're going to get this point slope into slope-intercept form by distributing the 2/3. So now we have y plus 2 is equal to 2/3 x minus 2/3. We're going to finish solving this by undoing the addition of 2 that's hanging out with the y by subtracting. So we're going to subtract by 2. Now, I'm going to subtract 2 away from the 2/3. The 2/3 is already written as a fraction, so I'm going to write minus 2 over 1 so that I can see that numerator, those numerators of 2 and the denominator of 3 and this denominator of 1 to make sure. And on the left-hand side, we have 2 minus 2 is equal to 0. On the right-hand side, I need to get this denominator of 1 to match with that denominator of 3. So I'm going to multiply the subtraction of 2 over 1. I'm going to multiply 2 over 1 by a form of 1. I'm going to multiply 2 by 3. and 1 by 3. Well, 3 divided by 3 is 1. And when you multiply by 1, you don't change the value of an answer. So we have y is equal to 2/3 x minus 2/3, negative 2 times 3 is negative 6 over, and 1 times 3 is 3. Our final answer here, we have two fractions with common denominators. Our final answer is going to be y is equal to 2/3 x minus negative 2 minus 6 is negative 8, or minus 8 over 3. So that is the equation of this line in slope-intercept form, and this is the equation of that line in point-slope form. Now, in a future video, I would like to take this equation of our line passing through these two points and put it into a setting of a real-life application. I'll post that soon within the next few days, where we interpret the y-intercept and the meaning of the slope as it applies to an application problem. But I hope that my deriving the point-slope form of a line from the slope formula helps you to gain a connection between all of these formulas that you're learning and allows you to find equations of lines in problems that are a little bit different than just giving you 2 points. So I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.